Atamare, no mai haere mai. Welcome back to this resumed council meeting. We have a little bit of business to do today and hopefully we can get through that reasonably quickly. I welcome Josephine, welcome to your first council meeting. I'm really pleased to have you here. And also Luke, who is returning again. Welcome back and great to have the youth councillors here. Councillors, we are live streaming the meeting. The live streaming is working this morning. We have an additional council meeting that I would like you to be aware of. There is a need to have the council meeting to consider several items prior to the next date that's set down, which is the 4th of May. So there will be an additional council meeting held on Thursday, the 13th of April, and it will start at 9 a.m. with the Planning and Regulatory Committee to follow. So the council will go first, and you'll get diary invitations very soon for those. Just before I get underway, I'd just like to note the passing of Edith Shaw. For some of you, you will have remember Edith. Edith was very involved with the school tree planting program for many, many years with council. And so if we look at some of those beautiful, beautiful green parts of Nelson, it's thanks to Edith's initiative, and her funeral was held a little over a week ago, and Mr. Petherham and Mr. Grundy attended on behalf of council. We have some remaining items on the agenda. We have the Civic House accommodation item, which is pages 144 to 149 in your agenda. There are no attachments for that matter, and we'll deal with that first, and then we'll move into public excluded to deal with the remaining items in the public excluded item. Now, just before we get underway, Councillor Barker has let me know before the meeting there's a procedural matter that he wishes to raise. So I'll hand to Councillor Barker.
Yeah, thank you, Your Worship. I wish to raise a point of order, and it's in relation to standing order number 3134 little e, which covers a breach of the standing orders or misinterpretation. The reason I'm raising this, Your Worship, is the ruling in relation to the amendment that I wish to put to the meeting at the last day of our sitting was ruled because I wanted to put the clause, the sections in relating to events back into it to be a direct negative. If you look at Standing Order 3912, when it defines what a direct negative is, a direct negative is one which, if carried, would have the same effect as negating the motion. My amendment in no way wanted to amend the motion to make a bylaw. It merely was an amendment to the content of it. And I believe what happened restricted the democratic principle of being able to amend the content of matters that are being dealt with. It did not seek to negate the motion, which was to make a bylaw. It simply wished to amend the content of the bylaw. And I believe that had it been allowed to take place, there may very well have been further amendments. But I believe that a lot of time was wasted, a tremendous amount of time was wasted, and at the end of the day, I don't think democracy was well served. So I want it recorded in the minutes. That is my standing, my point of order.
All right, you've raised a point of order, Councillor Barker, and Councillor Barker, if I've spoken about this earlier, with leave of Councillor Barker and leave of the meeting to, normally I'd have to rule on a standing order now, but with leave of the meeting to allow that to come back once we've dealt with the other matters, that would be my preference. And that just allows the Chief Executive and the Administration Advisors time to consider their advice to me in relation to that standing order. So with the leave of the meeting, you're happy to leave that to allow that time. Councillor Barker's happy to do that. That case, we'll leave that matter and I will come back to rule on that when we've finished with the other matters. All right, so we're now going to move on to the item in relation to Civic House. The report is on pages 144 to 149 of the agenda. And I will ask the officer to present the report. Welcome, Mr. Olson.
Mōrena.
Mōrena. We'll take the report as read. Are there any corrections or additions that need to be made to the report?
No, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Questions from Mr. Olson in relation to the report? Any questions? Councillor Noonan.
Thank you, Madam Chair, through you. I'm looking at the future decisions in at 5.4 where the two budget lines are mentioned. And I can't find any, and it has been a long time since I read this. I've had a few meetings in between. But I can't see what the total budget is going to be. And for the work that's outlined, I can't see that that funding and 5.4 is going to go anywhere near what's needed. So I just want a comment from the officer about what sort of budget are we going to be looking at, because the recommendation doesn't come back to us, and that's another matter I would probably raise when we get into debate.
Right, if we deal with the budget issue first. Thank you.
Thank you. Through you, Madam Chair. The two budget lines that are on there are the existing budget lines. The idea in putting out the RFP is to get the detailed costings all together so that we can know what the total costs are going to be at that point. We're unsure on what all of those costings will be until we get those detailed costings, at which point we can then bring that back to Council for further consideration.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. So it looks like it will come back to Council. I'd like that reflected in the recommendation that once those figures are set, because the way that it's worded at the moment, it's going to go to a workshop and then there's nothing about it coming back. I'd like that entered, please.
Well, would you like to have a go at amending, if you want to amend it, Councillor, then could you have a go at amending the words while I continue with the other questions, so if you'd like it modified?
I'd like to request some assistance with that, because it's not something I've done on the fly before.
Well,
is there an officer that can help?
I will keep going with the questions and I'll see if somebody can assist you with that. Councillor McGuirk.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Mayor. Tamati. At the end of this process, after the RFP, we've gone through and configured our office space. There is a possibility there is surplus space within the Civic House complex.
Through you, Madam Chair, there's existing surplus space at present.
Yeah. So if I could just explore, you'll be. There's a possibility you may have to reconfigure where staff are located and relocate as we refurbish, but at the end of it, we'll still have a surplus. Or it's likely that we'll have a surplus.
Through you, Madam Chair, again, that is a distinct possibility, but again, we won't know until we go through the exercise and get all the options in front.
Great, thank you.
With both officers and council.
Thank you. Councillor Barker.
Thank you, Your Worship.
Yes, I'm just questioning the process from here, option one or option two, and I appreciate the fact that councillors were taken on a tour of level one and could see what the situation is there. You're recommending option one, not option two, which was just talking about an upgrade of level one. So I'd like to know, at this stage, is option one looking at alterations to further or more than just level one? And I know that it's stated that elected members will get a chance to look at it under 611 at a later stage. Is there any concept plan at this stage before it goes out to the RFP to get an idea of what's planned? Is the intention to do just level one or more? And when can we have a look at just what the concept is?
Thank you.
Okay. Through you, Madam Chair. There are no existing concept plans at present. Yes, the idea of the accommodation report is to concentrate on level one as a priority point, but it's also designed to give council further options, including what are the possibilities with the remainder of the building, without making any commitment to that. It's just so council can have a greater idea of what are the options into the future.
Thank you.
All right, thank you. Councillor Courtney.
Thank you, Your Worship. Mr. Olson, included in that is at the top level as well, that's been empty for years. Is that going to be part of the whole overall plan that they're going to be looking at, formulating?
Through you, Madam Chair. The idea is, as we go through the immediate project, that we would use level six as a staging point that we can move staff to while areas are being reconfigured, brought up to standard, as it were. But yes, the idea for the longer term is the whole building and what are all the options for the whole building.
Thank you. Councillor McGuirk, Councillor, and then Councillor Laurie.
Madam Mayor, at this stage I'd like to indicate an amendment to the motion as discussed as just including a... I'll move that we actually receive the report.
Thank you.
And...
Seconded by Councillor Eklund. I'll just receive the report first. This all those in favour?
Aye.
Aye. Against? Carried.
Just an amendment.
Thank you for pre-circulating that, Councillor
In terms
McGuirk.
Of... I've just put up the recommendation with an amendment.
Before you move that, Councillor McGuirk, I'll just we're just addressing the issue that Councillor Noonan has raised, and it may be that we can get some agreement on what the words will be. But we'll get the words up here. And you, if you would like to speak to your reasoning for the additional words when they arrive, just Councillor McGuirk's now, and then we'll work on what Councillor Noonan's seeking if we need to. Thank you. If I could just ask you to pop your microphone on, thank you.
This will be the recommendation I propose to put up. But basically it's an issue that we indicate that there's an interest in the council to investigate the possibility of accommodating community groups within Civic House in any surplus space that may be there at the conclusion of this process. And the reason for that is, as members are well aware, or councillors are well aware, that the sixth floor has probably been empty for, 4 or 5 years. The state of Nazis is empty. Since the loss of the community house, a lot of the community groups are struggling to find accommodation. It makes a lot of sense to have them relocated in a central location where they can at least work collaboratively and jointly.
Happy to see you.
And the savings that we'll probably make is that they can put to their services, and probably council probably even receive a little bit of income. And it'll be actually good for vitality of this part of town to have workers, clients, visitors in the building. But at this stage, it's just an indication that we're open to the idea of accommodating community groups in Civic House.
Thank you, Councillor McGuirk. Now, we've got a seconder, but I also have some wording that I just want to try and tidy this all up in one go, if I can.
Madam Mayor, I'm happy to incorporate that into my amendment, if mine lies first.
Well, let's see if we can avoid having an amendment just to make this a little bit
faster. I just thought I'd make the whole motion with that and with
We've already got a mover and seconder, so what we're going to do is see whether your wording will be accommodated by the mover and seconder. So if we could just have the wording, and I'll go to the Chief Executive or Councillor Noonan, whoever's got this. Councillor Noonan, do you have the wording in front of you? And then you can just explain to us. See whether we can get this done in one go for efficiency's sake. A little bit of efficiency might be quite useful.
So the wording would be, requires an implementation plan and budget to be reported to Council before the letting of any contract for major physical works. And we've got health and safety matters accepted because they are normally addressed anyway.
Put it up on the screen, see if that is agreeable to the mover and seconder, and then we can get this sorted.
And the reason for the inclusion of that is that I think it's very important that we have a major plan, overall plan, and that we work to a plan. But I think it's also equally important that we know what we're spending before we do anything.
Questions, Councillor Eklund?
I've got no problem with that, but can I just clarify from the Chief Executive whether that would be a matter of course? I would have hoped, but perhaps not. Can I just check?
We couldn't quite hear the
Would
words.
Have that been a matter of course? I would have hoped.
A matter of course, right. Would that be a matter of course?
Through you, Madam Mayor, my answer to that in both parts, in relation to the reporting to Council and the health and safety matters being accepted, yes, it would be a matter of course.
Well, I mean, I'm happy to have it in. I mean, I think it speaks for itself.
Madam Mayor, if you don't mind.
I
wanted to incorporate
it. I have got a speaking order, but I'll let you jump at Councillor Noonan.
Thank you very much. The reason why I want that is that because there is too much getting lost with that are not on status reports, and I want it on a status report so we can keep a follow on it. It's very important that we follow our work. It's so easy to, we do a lot of work, and it's so easy to, things disappear. So as far as I'm concerned, I think it's really important.
Deputy Mayor.
Well done. Can I just ask a question of either the Chief Executive or Mr. Olson, and that is to the additional notes there that there is interest by Council to investigate accommodating community groups. Well, that, I suppose it depends on location. You could probably answer that way, but was it going to provide a new set of problems for us as far as security is concerned?
Madam Mayor, I think the officers have had a conversation. I know the officers have had a conversation about this, and thank you for the pre-circulating. And I think we would say that it would be difficult to determine that until after there'd been a workshop, until after the designers had been involved, in order to know where there may be surplus space and where it might be most appropriate to accommodate them.
Thank you. Thank you. Councillor Laurie, then Councillor Rutledge.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Through you. So Nelson City Council is only as good as the people who work here. Does the current state of parts of Civic House put people off wanting to come and work here?
Through you, Madam Chair. I don't know about putting them off, but it does impact on their productivity. We know this.
How do we know that? Through the Chair, how do we know this?
We know this through various forms, through our People Leaders Forum, when we're engaging regularly with people leaders and the discussions we're having with them. We know this through the other mechanisms like the SAF engagement surveys. It's held annually.
Sorry, Madam Chair, if I could just follow that up just very quickly. What sort of things do we hear back about the building and the state of the workspaces in that feedback?
Through you, Madam Chair. Most of the comments, most of the discussions we've had have been around having a fit for purpose building, a modern working area that meets the needs of our workforce and allows them to be productive. That's the general tenet of the comments we receive quite regularly.
Thank you. Councillor Rutledge.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. My question is, why are we not looking at this as an entire project, at least initially, and getting concept plans that allow us to see how everything might work through what the master plan is, particularly if we're looking at accommodating other people as opposed to potentially a piecemeal approach?
Mr. Olson, let me just clarify the scope.
Thank you, through you, Madam Chair. There's a two-pronged approach here. The first part of the process is dealing with the immediate issue, and that is the level one, the physical security review, those aspects. But just as importantly, besides that, there is a lack of a master plan, and that is the second part of the process, in allowing the council to have a much greater overview on the whole complex, because when we talk about Civic House, we're not talking just about one building, we're talking about three buildings, well, two now, so, you know, that's the whole idea. And sitting besides that, the other complicating matter, getting to a master plan, long-term vision, is the symbiotic nature of the buildings, the tower block and the telecom annex, which is a very complicated issue to deal with. We don't own the annex.
Right, thank you. Councillor Skinner, and I really want to move this along, please.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Just with the ex-State Advances building and the top floor of this building, how does this all fit in the bigger picture of us wanting to, or potentially wanting to lease or rent or sell those portions?
Through you, Madam Chair. The State Advances building, the Council's already made a decision in relation to the State Advances building, and we will be proceeding with that process over the next short while and seeking expressions of interest for that building. In terms of the lease arrangements for the rest of Civic House, again, that will be part of the broader, longer-term aspect of the project and understanding just what is our potential for leasing, renting, and other.
Thank you. And Madam Mayor, we've been unsuccessful to date in leasing State Advances and upstairs. Are there changes we can make to those buildings and part of the bigger picture? What are we doing to better our chances of selling it or leasing it or put community groups in it?
I think, Councillor Skinner, that the last time the process went through for State Advances building, there were some questions about its earthquake-prone status, and they now have been advanced and what I would call a comprehensive expression of interest process will commence. I'm very keen to get that underway. We discussed that through the annual plan process and said, come on, let's get on with it. So let's get on with it.
I recall that, but hadn't we not put it on the market since then? Have we not? We've failed to get a interest in that, something I would have thought we would have been successful in.
Mr. Olson?
So as far as I'm aware, that we only went through that exercise once previously, and as the Mayor has pointed out, we've since then got some more comprehensive reports done on the state of Answers building, which has given us a much clearer picture of the state of that building. We're now ready, and following up on the Council's decision, to now go back out to market and seek.
Thank you. Right, I've just got one question in relation to this additional clause for the Chief Executive. We've got a clause there added by Councillor Noonan, and I'm getting a sense that the mover and seconder are happy to accept that, even though it may be somewhat redundant. My concern is it perhaps raises an issue that was not intended, but may have been, that with the health and safety matters accepted being in the brackets there, that makes no comment about the budget and whether that's within budget or not. And if I was to read that, that might be read to mean that major physical works in relation to health and safety could be entered into that were not within budget, where there was no budget provision. What was the intent? Because I wouldn't be comfortable with that. I prefer to stick with the status, which is that unbudgeted expenditure needs to come to Council. Chief Executive.
Madam Chair, the intention of that clause and the bracket of the health and safety matters accepted was that sometimes Council's processes can take some time. Intention of the report overall is to be coordinated. However, it does recognise that there may be some physical works that are required that would be smaller in nature that should be addressed under the matters to address health and safety matters. And the intention of inserting the words in the brackets was to explain that that may occur, not to say we would spend all of the budget, but to say to stop Council from feeling that if it occurred, that that had not been taken into account. It's a little bit redundant in itself, but it's an effort to be entirely transparent that there may be small physical works required if there was a timing delay.
Right, so if we were to add the words health and safety matters within budget accepted, I know that sounds, you'd be comfortable with that, I just think as it reads at the moment it gives gives no constraint, it actually creates a perverse outcome in terms of adding in things that are probably not needed to be added in. So within budget, right. All right, now if we're happy with that, I think we can move on. It's been moved and seconded. Any debate? No debate. Debate, Councillor Noonan, Councillor Skinner.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I welcome a bigger vision for this building. I think it's very important that we have a long plan. We do quite a lot ad hoc, and it's got to change, and the building has been done different levels at different times with no overall thinking at all. I welcome this because it will give us a plan for a long time. It doesn't matter how long it takes, but we need to know what we're doing. And I think it's a great report, and I thank the officer for bringing it to us so that we can approve something that we can work along to.
Councillor Skinner.
Thank you. So I support this, and it's fortunate we've got some empty spaces so we can work around when these changes are happening. But I'm also very conscious that we've had a large building on prime location, state advances and upstairs, vacant for so long, so it's something that our ratepayers have an investment on, and it's been sitting there for idle for, I realise, for various reasons. So I'm keen that we get that either off our books or on our books or whatever and get a return from it. I realise whatever we're doing here is going to take the time it takes, but from a commercial perspective and for the interests of our investors, our ratepayer, that we're as speedily as possible and not let this hold up future use of state advances in the top story, because it's been far too long vacant. It's killing me, absolutely killing me how long it's been vacant. And if you were a private owner of those buildings, it'd be killing you.
Councillor Barker.
Thank you. Yes, I too support it in principle. There's two points that I have been considering. I'm happy to see the words "to investigate" put into the third or fourth clause there, the added note, because I wouldn't like to see a message go out to our community that it was definitely going to happen. Nelson's not the only place where the earthquake actually affected community houses. There was one in Ashburton, which I learned an awful lot about last weekend, which was successfully reinstated in a new building. Of course, Ashburton suffered that attack on someone in the government department, a fatal attack. The other point that I am just a little concerned about, and Mr. Olson told me that the concept plans will be looked at some stage later. In the option one on page 147, it quite clearly states that RFP will provide advice and concept plans and will allow informed decision making. So I want to see the concept plans at the earliest opportunity, because I'm just a little confused as to, from the two parts of the report, as to when we're going to see the concept plans.
Thank you, Councillor Barker. I'll just comment, Councillor Skinner, I'm happy to support this. The State Advances building is on its separate pathway. There was some discussion about it coming into the annual plan. It's caused me a great degree of frustration. I share your frustration about how long it's taken to get the expressions of interest process out there. And when I had the advice that it was going to come in for another round of consultation through the annual plan, I went, no, we went, no, let's get on with it. So I'm in your camp on that and look forward to seeing comprehensive expression of interest process underway and then a decision made by this council to get some vitality back into the city, given the presentation we had from at Works and Infrastructure this morning. We are a property owner and we've got some responsibilities as well. But to put it, all those in favour, aye, against, carried. I think that concludes the matters that need to be dealt with in public, other than the ruling, which I will come back to at the conclusion of the public excluded business. So I will now move us into public excluded, seconded by the Deputy Mayor. I will put that. All those in favour, aye, against, carried. And Josephine and Luke, I'm not quite sure how long we're going to be in dealing with the public excluded business. Hopefully not too long, but that's up to the people sitting around this table. So hopefully there's somebody who can find you somewhere to be comfortable till we're finished. Thank you.
before you go back to public, before you... And we're back in public, and we've got one more item we need to address in public. So we had a point of order, and thank you for your patience in allowing us to have some time in relation to this. The Chief Executive has just passed me a piece of paper, but I think as it's the Chief Executive's advice, the Chief Executive should read that in relation to her advice in relation to the point of order.
Madam Mayor, the officer advice would be that the motion as moved and seconded relating to the draft city amenity bylaw had a number of clauses to it. You were to receive it, you were to determine that it was the most appropriate form of bylaw, you were to determine a matter in relation to the Bill of Rights, and you were proposing, what was proposed was the approval of the statement of proposal with the removal of part 12 events and any consequential amendments, and agreed that a number of parties be delegated to approve any minor amendments. Councillor Barker proposed an amendment removing the wording in clause 4 of the motion, which was with the removal of part 12 events and any consequential amendments. The officer advises that this would amount to a direct negative of clause 4 and therefore the motion, because the motion on the table was to specifically exclude part of the bylaw from being put out to public consultation. Therefore, an amendment to include those parts of the bylaw would have had the effect of negating the motion. That was the reason for the...
So, microphone, Councillor Barker.
I've taken legal advice, and it's quite clear that the amendment was not attempting to negate the effect of the motion. It was still allowing that a motion be established the amendment in no way was a direct negative to the motion. It was dealing with a part of the bylaw. And as is normal, even through Parliament, you get a bill up there. Every clause can be debated and amended. To actually say that that amendment would have negated the whole motion, I think, is absolutely incorrect, and I'll be taking this further if...
Well, I haven't ruled resolved yet, so you've raised a point of order, and what I'm going to do is, with leave of the Deputy Mayor, I'm going to just adjourn the council meeting so you can have a cup of tea, because it's actually 11 o'clock now. I'll come back very quickly to deal with that matter after the cup of tea, so we'll just adjourn for 10 minutes, and then we'll very quickly deal with that matter, and I'll close my council meeting, and the Deputy Mayor can start his works and infrastructure meeting. Thank you.
we can deal with this last matter. Just ask for you to take your seats.
Just for your own information.
Just resuming the meeting, we got to the point of order that had been raised by Councillor Barker in relation to direct negatives, and I adjourned so that I could just consider my response to that. I'm going to uphold the point of order from Councillor Barker. I will now close the meeting, and thank you for your attendance.